Sunday, this may be a little down. It feels like it's packed in here right now. So thank you very much for being here this morning. Oh, good morning, Facebook people as well. I'm not very social media savvy. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Very good morning. Let me direct your attention to the flowers. The altar flowers for Sunday are to the glory of God and in thanks and praise that we are together again in God's house. Can I get an amen for that? Thank you. Any announcements this morning?
Praise God.
Lisa?
I have three. The UMW annual meeting will be virtual, and that is next Sunday at 2 o'clock. So if anyone wants to Zoom on that meeting, give me a call, and I'll give you the contact information or the Zoom meeting number. Upper rooms are right here by the door, so pick those up if you would like. And then the last one, obviously, this would have been barbecue weekend, so we all usually spend money on the barbecue. So if you would like to give just an extra donation to try to help us offset some of that profit that we have missed, that would just be this would be a great time to do it. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. And speaking of offering, we won't have a formal offering taking today, but there are offering plates kind of right in the middle and then right by the door. So as Lisa said, we did miss the barbecue this weekend, and we all know financially how important that is. So if you're able to do a little extra, then certainly do appreciate it.
Oh,
scholarship be more important than the finances? Yes, ma'am. Any other announcements? About any parent concerns?
Remember Ronnie Thrower as he continues to recover from a heart transplant.
I'm praised that Barbara Prater is here, but we need to continue to pray for all of her tests.
Thank you.
Very good to have Barbara here this morning, and Jane as well. Surgeries and tests recently, and very good to have you all with us as well. Me?
Yeah, keep Williams and Ford family in prayer. We lost our cousin Richie Ford yesterday to COVID. He was an RN in Birmingham.
Yes, ma'am.
I've got a family that I work with giving their daughter some Spanish lessons. They're having some issues right now, and the last name is Matute, M-A-T-U-T-E, and so I'm going to have this in prayer list, so that's just the story with them right now. She's 18 and trying to move out, but we've lost contact with her, and we're kind of worried about this young lady, the daughter of the family.
Yep, the Matute.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Any others? I see Jonah. I'll just keep him in prayer. Maybe going to work here shortly. All right, there are no others. We'll take these to the Lord in prayer.
Friends, this morning the prayer is going to be a responsive prayer. It's based on one, based actually on an ancient prayer written by John Chrysostom. Long ago, but when I pray, let us pray to the Lord. Your response will be, Lord, hear our prayer. Let's try it. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord,
hear our prayer.
For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the peace of the world, for the unity of the Church of God, and for the well-being of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord. Lord,
hear our prayer.
For this gathering of the faithful, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord,
hear our prayers.
For all the baptized, for all who serve in the church, let us pray to the Lord. Lord,
hear our prayers.
For our elected officials, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. Lord,
hear our prayers.
For this city, and for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord,
hear our prayers.
For the good earth that God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord. Lord,
hear our prayers.
For those who are aged and infirm, for those who are widowed or orphaned, and for those who are sick and suffering, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those who are poor and oppressed, for those who are unemployed and destitute, for those who are imprisoned and captive, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Almighty Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your beloved Son that when two or three are gathered in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now our desires and petitions as may be best to us, as our prayers are lifted through your Spirit to heaven's throne. And we pray as Christ has taught his disciples. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Jesus, and me.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What gain has the worker from his toil? I have seen the business that God has given to the children of man to be busy with. He has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity into man's heart, yet so that he cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I perceive that there is nothing better for them than to be joyful and to do good as long as they live. Also, that everyone should eat and drink and take pleasure in all his toil. This is God's gift to man. I perceive that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor anything taken from it. God has done it, so that people fear before him. That which is already has been. That which is to be already has been. And God seeks what has been driven away. Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
The children come down for the children's message, please.
Good morning, everyone. It's so good to see you again. We have a special story for you today, and Josh is going to start with that.
Okay, who here knows who Peter Parker is? Anybody? Peter Parker? Peter Parker? Do you know who Peter Parker is? Who is Peter Parker? Yes, that's right. Okay, Peter Parker was a nerdy little average kid. And then one day something happened to him. Do you know what happened to him? Got bit by a radioactive spider, and he became Spider-Man. You knew that. You knew that too. Yeah. Okay. And so, he became Spider-Man. And this was not on purpose. It was an accident that he got bit by this spider. So, Rosa is going to tell you about another Peter from the Bible whose life was changed, and it was not an accident what happened to him.
Now, who knows who Simon Peter is from the Bible? You know who Simon Peter is? Ah, that's great. Who is him? He was a fisherman, wasn't it, Ethan? Yeah. So, Simon Peter, one day he was fishing with his brother, and they weren't really catching anything. But Jesus came and said, "Follow me." And Simon and his brother decided to follow Jesus. Jesus told them, "I'm going to make you fishermen of men." Do you know what that means? Okay, fishers of men means like he was going to get more people to follow Jesus, more Christians like all of us here. And Simon decided to follow Jesus, and that changed his life forever. Do you know something cool that Peter did from the Bible? Okay, you're going to learn it today. He walked on water. What did Simon do, Simon Peter? Walked on water. He's the only man known after Jesus that he had walked on water. So his decision to follow Jesus changed his life forever, and that wasn't an accident. he was chosen by Jesus. Jesus came to him and chose him to do that. The same way we all are. We are chosen by Jesus, and Jesus loved us so much that he came and died for us. So Josh is going to read us the scripture where this is found, and he's going to close us in prayer.
All right, so it's Matthew 4, verses 18 through 20. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he saith unto them, Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets and followed him. All right, now we're going to say a prayer. Okay. Lord, bless these children and just keep them safe and keep them healthy and just let them know that you love them and you have a purpose for them in their lives. And just be with all of us this week as we go back to work or go back to school. And just please keep us all safe and keep us healthy. And we love you so much. Amen.
Amen.
Now you can get some candy.
Thanks, Josh and Rosa. At this time, you can stand up and give your neighbor a socially distant wave or an elbow bump.
Good morning, good morning. Let's praise God by clapping our hands again for the beautiful music we've heard this morning. Be glad when we can sing together one of these days, but that really does lift my heart. So I thank you, Drew. That's beautiful. Oh, it's so good to see everybody this morning. It really is. Have you hugged a tree lately? I hear laughter, but I'm very serious about that. Our text today in Ecclesiastes that Drew read says there's a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. And we are in that time right now when we need to refrain from embracing one another. And that's difficult. It's difficult to do that, right? I mean, it's hard not to just go up and hug people who you love, but you can hug a tree. And why not? It will make you feel better. And it will make the tree feel better too. Now, I may be going a bit too far there. I don't know for sure that trees feel when you hug them. But trees really are fascinating. I mean, we don't give trees enough credit sometimes. I mean, trees are alive. And there's a lot going on with trees. I mean, just as human beings are social creatures, trees are actually social too. Trees, you know this, trees can communicate with each other through, and this is real, I mean, through fungus in the ground, they found that trees in areas that get lots of light or lots of nitrogen can actually transfer nutrients to other trees who are not getting as much of those resources. And so this means that healthy trees can help sick trees. There's actually I just think it's fascinating. I'm gonna continue along this. In sub-Saharan Africa, there's an excellent example. When the leaves of an acacia tree start to get eaten by giraffes, the tree notices that, and it puts out a distress signal. And when it does, it starts pumping out ethylene gas, and then the neighboring trees start pumping chemicals into their leaves so that it can possibly make the giraffes sick, so they'll stop getting their leaves eaten. I mean, they hear from the other one, oh, that guy over there is getting eaten by a giraffe. Let me pump out some of these chemicals so I don't get eaten either. That is fascinating. I mean, that's wild that trees can do that. That trees will protect each other. It's amazing. They actually do communicate with each other. And, I mean, as we know, trees are on a completely different timeline than one another as well. On average, trees live way longer than human beings. The oldest tree living today, they say, is a great bristlecone pine tree in California that they believe to be over 5,000 years old. I mean, there's a bonsai tree that's about 500 years old that survived the atomic bombing in Hiroshima in 1945. I mean, trees must perceive time so much differently than us. And the preacher of Ecclesiastes today has some things to say about time. Ecclesiastes is a book in the Bible, and in Hebrew it's actually called Koholet, and Koholet means the preacher. It's written by someone calling themselves Son of David. Some say that's Solomon, some say it could be someone else who's using a more general term, a Son of David. But so the preacher in Ecclesiastes has a lot to say about time. And when I read this passage today, I start to hear that the bird song. You'll know the bird song, it's got the twangy guitar, and you feel like you're in an episode of The Wonder Years when you hear it. Anyway, it's a famous passage, and it's a profound passage. It tells a truth about our lives, and it tells a truth about our world that we kind of all know deep down. And then when we read it, we say, yeah, I feel the same way too. I've always felt the same way. For everything, there is a season, not just for some things, but for everything. There's a time for things to happen, and there's a time for other things to happen. There's a time for planting. There's a time for plucking up what has been planted. There's a time to break down. There's a time to build up, a time to seek, and a time to lose. As I said in the beginning of the sermon, there's a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. And y'all, the time to embrace will come back. It'll roll around again. This, everybody wearing masks, this pandemic, it's not going to last forever. But we live in that refraining time right now. And when the preacher says there's a time for everything, it's not giving justification or permission for all those things to happen. It's not saying there is some times when it's okay to hate, or that there's a time when you absolutely should go to war, or there's a time when you're supposed to kill. It's just saying these things are going to happen. It seems to be a part of life. All that is part of human existence, and it's bound to come around once again on its turn in the wheel of life, the wheel of time. Everything happens in its own time. This is the totality of God, the totality of eternity. Though things can seem so monumental here in the lifespan of eternity, what we do is barely the blink of an eye. I mean, I look at my daughter, I look at Marissa, and my wife and Marissa can't be here today. Mercy is expecting another child, and so she's just staying extra cautious. But I look at Marissa, and I realize that I probably won't really know Marissa's grandchildren. At some point, I'm going to die. And that's true for everyone in here, right? We're all going to die at some point or another. And I don't say that to be depressing or morose. I say that because it's the truth. It's grace. Truth is grace. Now stay with me. Where would we be without death? What would the beauty of life be if death were not a reality? Without that, there'd be no meaningful art. There would be no symphonies. There'd be no monuments. There'd be no real reason to cherish our memories. Why would we even have children? What would life be without death? Because really, this is very true, we've all been living through a season, a long season of death. This has been a season of death, of death tolls recorded and reminders to wear masks to keep everybody healthy and talks of flattening the curve and social distancing to stay what? 6 feet apart, which is also the number of feet under the ground to typically bury the dead. Again, I'm not saying this to be depressing. I'm saying it because it's true. And this is a truth that it's easier to voice and easier to bear when we're with a room full of our Christian brothers and sisters than it is when we're watching a worship service by ourselves. But it's just the truth. It's the truth of what the preacher says. There is a time to be born, and there is a time to die. But there's a different kind of time that we live in. Just as trees perceive time, must perceive time so differently than we do. We live in kingdom time. We're not just gears in some grand cosmic clock where we're in this fixed pattern and we have no choice in the matter. We live in a different kind of time. See, the ancient Greeks had two words that they used for time. There was the word chronos, which was plain, ordinary, day-to-day time. That's where you get the word chronology. 11 a.m., time for church. 6:30 p.m., time for dinner. 7:30 a.m., time for the men's Zoom meeting. October 31st, Halloween, all that stuff. That's the plain, ordinary chronos. But there's another word the Greeks used for time. And it meant, in Greek, it meant the time for opportunity. That's kairos. Kairos is the word they use. And so in the New Testament being written in Greek, particularly the Gospel of John, that's the word that's used when we say the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of heaven has come near. So we're going through this day-to-day chronos. But at the same time we go through that, we know that Jesus Christ is King. That Christ sits enthroned upon the highest heaven. And so right now, because of that, this very moment is pregnant with possibility. It's like the Greeks would have the metaphor of an archer, and the archer would pull back his bow. And the moment when the archer was ready to let go of the arrow, so that it would go into the bullseye, the moment when it was pulled back exactly right and the sight was right, that's kairos. That's the time of opportunity. That's kingdom time. That we live these lives when each and every moment we inhabit is an opportunity to follow God. Because there's a time for birth, and there's a time for death. There's also a time of resurrection. What comes next? We can ask that question and we can become very gloomy. We can become doomsayers and we can just say, well, things are just getting worse and worse. And things are never going to get better. And maybe the preacher in Ecclesiastes might say that too. There's a time for pessimism and there's a time for optimism. There's a time for despair and a time for hope. And I think this is the time for hope. I take a lot of comfort in reading. I read this the other day, and it's about the bubonic plague. The bubonic plague in the Middle Ages. The plague in the 1300s was a devastating tragedy for Europe and Asia. I mean, cities were just decimated. There were hundreds of thousands died. Businesses failed, and unemployment rose, and there was a breakdown of social order. An author, Boccaccio, wrote at the time that people gave themselves in to all sorts of excess. He wrote, "Thus doing exactly as they prescribed, they spent day and night moving from one tavern to the next, drinking without mode or measure, or doing the same thing in other people's homes, engaging only in those activities that gave them pleasure. And they combined this bestial behavior with as complete an avoidance of the sick as they could manage." And so then, what happened as the plague passed, people started to become more and more suspicious of the sins and the excesses of the church. And there was a spiritual renewal. where an individual's relationship to God, rather than an individual's relationship to the church, became more important. And wages went up for laborers. Laborers became merchants, and merchants became members of the nobility. And a person's destiny was no longer fixed by birth. Your merit and your ability started to matter much more. Literature and art began to flourish as people became more grateful for the gift of life, became more educated. So in a very real way, you see, the bubonic plague was responsible for the Renaissance. And so I think here now, right now, today, it's time for hope. To affirm, along with the preacher in Ecclesiastes, that God has set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know there's nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. We live in kingdom time. We have such an opportunity to redeem time, as Christ has redeemed our time. God has given us this time today, and it is a great gift. Now is the time of salvation. Now is the time when we realize that it's not just about us, but that God's love is something we can and we should share in the big ways and in the small ways. That God desires all His children to eat and drink and find satisfaction in their toil. It's why a team here at Mount Zion has been hard at work building something called Project 1213. It takes its name from Romans 1213, which says, contribute to the needs of the saints and extend hospitality to strangers. And what we're hoping to do with Project 1213 is to launch a food co-op in which people just around here in our neighborhood can join and receive boxes of food each week. So they don't have to worry whether this month they buy food or buy medicine, or have to go sometimes without dinner so their child can eat. It's still in the planning stages, but it's rapidly, it's building up. And so Project 1213 is just one way that we act on God's opportunity to serve Him, God's kingdom time, the time that's pregnant with possibility, not taking the time we have for granted or pretending that the time just belongs to us, but taking a cue from the trees, who know that it's best to have all the trees nearby healthy and nourished. The time is now. Let's not get distracted and forget that we live in the time of the King. And it's so easy to get distracted sometimes. Sometimes we can spend so much time in distraction. I don't want to spend my time in distraction. I get distracted. There's an author, Joan Chittister, tells a story, which I think is so appropriate. A disciple is talking to his teacher. And the disciple says to his teacher, where shall I look for enlightenment? He asks. Teacher says, here. Disciple asks, when will it happen? Wise teacher says, it is happening right now. Then why don't I experience it? Because you don't look, the teacher says. Disciple says, what should I look for? Nothing. Just look. Look at what? At anything your eyes light on. But must I look in a special way? Teacher says, no, the ordinary way will do. Disciple asks, but don't I always look in the ordinary way? No, you don't. Well, why not? The teacher says, because to look, you must be here. And you are mostly somewhere else. Yeah. Here we are. And it's good to be here today in the time of the King. Jesus knew when it was time to give his life, to go to the cross for every single one of us. As Drew sang in the beginning of worship, Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease, 'tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. That we can entrust ourselves to God just as Jesus did, knowing that a new time beckons, written of in Revelation, of the new heaven and the new earth, a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. As it was in the beginning, is now, my friends, and forever shall be, world without end. Be with you now and forever.
I'm going to kind of exit out in groups and go on outside. And if you want to stand 6 feet and catch up, great, do so, okay? But we're not going to do it in here just to be safe. And we'll make sure we do that as carefully as possible. So thank you so much. We'll see all you next week. Thank you, Josh and Drew and Andy and everybody that had something to do with this. We had a lot of workers here, and I just appreciate everything you did. I love you all, okay? Thank you. So this group right here.